Welcome. My name is John Perticullius, and I'm the president of CompuPlast in North America. CompuPlast provides simulation software and engineering services to equipment manufacturers and polymer processing companies worldwide. Today's presentation is titled Analysis of Extrusion and Coextrusion Problems with Simulation, and it is meant to give you an idea of how simulation can be used to solve problems more efficiently, or preferably, avoid them altogether. I would like to begin with some benefits of extrusion simulation. Firstly, extrusion simulation provides a better understanding of the process and the complex relationship between the variables in that process. Simulation is much more efficient than experimentation because we can do the experiments within the virtual environment and not have to actually go to the cost of building machinery or wasting polymer and energy. The accuracy of simulation improves with the calibration of the simulation using experimental data or process data. I don't want people to get the idea that, you know, you can sit in a black box and pull up the simulation and optimize the design based purely on theory. It really needs a little bit of calibration with process data to be optimized and become more precise. And it does need a little experience with respect to proper interpretation of the results. And that's really where we come in and when we support our customers and show them what the colors and information, all the graphs and stuff that you get can be overwhelming. We show them what's important, what's not important, and what to focus on. And once the process or problem is better understood using simulation, then we can go to a more direct solution in terms of solving that problem or optimizing that geometry. So just some of the extrusion problems that we've solved using simulation. Here's a partial list here. And what I've done is I've picked some of the more common ones and a couple that aren't so common but are quite interesting to present. So some of the typical extrusion problems that are going to be presented here are problem with excessive screw wear, melt temperature variation, and I must say probably 75% of all our consulting services somehow come around the topic of melt temperature and melt temperature variation. Polymer degradation, which is kind of associated with high temperatures, and unstable profile extrusion. A lot of times when people are doing extruding profiles, they've got a process that they're constantly tweaking or have to adjust to stay in spec with the profile. And finally, coextrusion instability problems. All of these have some sort of cost associated with them. And if you really apply the simulation to optimize these, you can significantly reduce the amount of expenses that you have when you're fighting these types of problems. Now, the simulation that we use is the CompuPlast Virtual Extrusion Laboratory suite of CAE tools. It consists of about 12 modules, each developed to simulate a specific component in the extrusion process. So, for example, we have an extruder module, we have several die modules, a cooling module. And by doing it in the module approach, it makes the software easier to use and much, much more efficient for the user to come up with an optimized solution. So the first example I wanted to start off with was excessive screw wear and damage. And sometimes when the processors pull a screw, they'll find a discoloration on the surface. We originally thought that this might be due to excessive temperature, you know, but it needs about 1,000 degrees to turn chrome steel blue. So this discoloration we later determined was due to high surface stress. And this is a screw from a groove feed extruder. And you can see here right at the end of the grooves, the high pressure that's generated creates a very, very obvious discoloration in the screw surface. We also have screw flight wear due to the high forces. So for example, if you look at the screw flight here, there's a definite width to it. Here it's a little narrower. And at this point, it becomes a knife edge. And one might ask, what happened to this metal that wore off this screw? Obviously it's extruded out into the process. And you can imagine the type of force required to file down the flight using the polymer. And if the forces get high enough, you can even scrape the chrome off the surface. You can see here, first, the forces were high enough to discolor the screw, and then ultimately, portions of that surface were scraped right off. So we're dealing with very, very high forces if the design isn't made properly. Now, in the extreme case, the screw can experience catastrophic failure, as shown here on a 150 millimeter diameter or 6-inch screw, which broke into two pieces.
And this isn't due to a cold start. It happened at the pretty much thickest part of the screw while it was in production.
And this company that experienced this failure, they experienced it on one screw. They replaced the screw with a new one, of course, the same screw design. And within almost exactly the same amount of time, the second screw failed. So it's obviously not a mechanical defect in the material. It's a design flaw. So before I can explain what we look at in the simulation, I just want to give you a little bit of background in the type of results that we look at and what they mean. So when the polymer goes into a single screw extruder into the hopper, it is compressed in the feed section. And then as it moves along the feed section of the screw, a portion of the polymer starts to melt, creating a melt pool on the pushing flight. And then we still have the solid bed. And as you move along, the solid bed gets narrower and narrower while the melt pool gets wider and wider. And ultimately, we want to have all the polymer melted before we get to the end of the screw. Here's a photo from a glass window extruder experiment. And here you can see the solid bed, which is the gray area, and the melt pool when the polymer melts, in this case polyethylene, it's amorphous. And so you can see the root of the screw, it's clear. And just to define some parameters here, we have the channel width, which is from flight to flight, and we have the solid bed width and the melt pool. And the solid bed width reduction is a parameter that we look at, which is the solid bed ratio. It's the solid bed width divided by the channel width. And this is the ratio is used to show how the material melts along the screw. It's an indication of the melting rate. Now, when we have a screw with this catastrophic failure, we took this particular design. You can see it's a barrier type screw. And we analyzed it using the CompuPlast Virtual Extrusion Laboratory Extruder Module. And this graph shows the solid bed profile along the screw. So here's a cut or showing a cross section in this position of the screw. We have the melt channel and the solid bed, and here's our barrier flight right in here. So the yellow represents the solid material. So what happened is that the material at this point starts to melt, the solid bed starts to reduce, and that's fine. The barrier section is introduced, and then the solid bed starts to increase. And this doesn't mean that the material is solidifying. The solid bed is a linear measurement of the width of the solid bed, not the volume. So as the melt channel is compressing, the solid channel is compressing and getting shallower and shallower, if the compression of the solid channel is higher than the melting rate, it's going to squeeze the solid bed. And ultimately, in this case, you can see the solid bed got squeezed till it went back up to a value of 1, which means the entire channel is full of solid material. And that usually limits the production rate. And normally, that's the only problem that that causes. However, in this particular design, it was a little bit more dramatic of a problem, more serious of a problem here. What I'm showing on this graph is, again, the solid bed ratio in black corresponding to the axis on the left. And the blue line is called the relative unmelted amount and shows the amount of material that's still unmelted. And that corresponds to the axis on the right.
And what you can see is here, even though the solid bed ratio reaches 1, the material continues to melt. But right at the end of the barrier section, you can see here that the change in the geometry or the closing off of the barrier section is rather abrupt. And this causes a wedge force by the remaining solid material, which is still about 20-30% unmelted material at this point. And that's being forced to melt by a rapid reduction in the channel depth. Typically, this results in normal flight and barrel wear. But in this case, the channel depth reduction was too abrupt, and with 30% unmelted material, this caused an excessive unbalanced force and in the screw, pushing the screw to one side. And of course, because of the rotation, this was a periodic screw deflection. This leads to cyclic fatigue failure. And if you do the calculation, 75 RPM, 60 minutes, 24 hours, 365 days, that works out to about 40 million cycles per year. And generally, when you get into the millions of cycles, that's when things in metal start to fail. And so this rapid change in geometry, creating a high force on the screw, caused the screw to actually bend, and the screw would wobble back and forth. And once it gets up to, I think it was about 30 million cycles, that's when this screw failed and broke. The solution, once you understand that, the solution is pretty straightforward. Modify the barrier geometry so that the melting is not restricted and the solids are completely melted before you squeeze out. And you don't squeeze out abruptly. You do the transitions at least over one diameter, and that way you balance out the force all the way around the screw. So simulation helps you ensure that you've done that. The next topic I'd like to talk about is melt temperature and melt temperature variation. And I want to use two polymers, a 1MI low-density polyethylene and a 1MI linear low-density polyethylene. And this has caused a lot of problems in the industry simply because both of these polymers are referred to as 1MI. And the problem is that 1MI means that the material was measured, its melt index was measured at a very low shear rate, and these two materials happen to cross in their viscosity curves. This is what we're showing here, the viscosity versus shear rate. And you can see that in the low shear rate region, so this is 10 to the 0, that's shear rate of 1, and this would be shear rate about 2, 3, they have the same viscosity, so they have the same melt index. However, in the processing region, now this is 100 reciprocal seconds shear rate, and this is typically where we process the polymers, we can see that the viscosity difference is almost 3 times, with the linear low being much more viscous than the low density. And as a result, people that assume that because they have the same melt index, I can process them in the same screw, would run into problems. So the key thing here is try to obtain the full viscosity curves of the polymers that you're processing so that you can see if they match in the processing range, then yes, they're a direct change. If they don't, then you know to expect that the 1MI linear will have much more power draw, have higher pressure drop through the dyes and so forth, everything related to it being much more viscous than the 1MI low density. In this case, a very common problem would be that you design a 3.5-inch screw, let's say, for 1MI LDP, and here's just a typical standard screw design, and we simulate this screw and get an output rate. Here I got 157 kilos, a little over 300, 330 pounds an hour at 75 RPM, and a bulk average temperature of 208 degrees Celsius. Now this is the bulk average temperature. What we like to do in the simulation is look at what the temperature variation is at the exit, and that's shown here by the this graph. This graph represents this section through the gap, that's what this arrow is, And that little dot there represents this point here near the barrel surface. And this is the maximum temperature, 212. So we have an average of 208 and a maximum of 212. That's about as good as you're going to get in terms of having a low temperature variation. And this screw should process this material quite acceptably. Now, the problem comes when somebody says, oh, I have a 1 mm LDP screw. I can use a 1 mm LDP also in that material. It's the same viscosity because they're both 1 mm. And you throw in the 1 mm LDP, and we look at the results. We get a little bit more output. The solid bed width is very similar. It melts, at least it finishes prior to the end of the screw, so that's good. All the material has melted. But if we look at the bulk average temperature, we've gone over 30 degrees Celsius hotter with the 1 mm LDP material based on the viscous heating created by the higher viscosity material. And not only that, if we look at the temperature variation across the gap at the end of the screw, what we'll see is that the temperature here is much higher in the middle. In fact, it's not what we think, 239 bulk average. It hits 253 degrees Celsius. And so when this material comes off the screw and flows in the adapter, what we're showing here is the temperature gradient that we would experience in that adapter. The barrels are set, let's say, at 200. Let's say we hold our adapter wall at 200. And the melt temperature in the middle is scooting along at 250 degrees Celsius. And if we're fortunate enough to have a melt temperature thermocouple probe in there with a standard 1/8 inch immersion, we might be able to pick up in the gradient a temperature of 215 degrees C. And many, many, many processors are misled by this type of scenario where they're measuring the temperature near the barrel wall and they feel that their melt temperature is 215 degrees C and quite acceptable, when in fact their temperature is actually much higher than that, because this is where the bulk of the material is flowing and it's hitting at temperatures in excess of 250 degrees Celsius. So it's very, very important to have an optimized screw that gives you a very uniform melt temperature, because this is what's going into your dies and affecting your die distribution, all your die performance, the flow uniformity. All those things are affected by this temperature variation. Another very good handy tool to have is a variable depth thermocouple. That is a thermocouple that you can push in and get a measurement throughout your flow field and get a real good idea of what sort of uniformity you really have in your product, because the more uniform temperature you can send into your downstream equipment, like your dies, the more uniform final product you're going to make. And this also affects even the cooling of the product. If you have a large temperature variation going into your die, that's also going to come out of your die and affect how your product shrinks and perhaps warps during the cooling of the material. The next item I'd like to talk about is polymer degradation. This goes hand in hand with the high melt temperature. But more importantly, I'm going to look at it from the fact of just poor design. So here's a situation that we come across quite often. Typically, when you purchase an extruder, you're going to get a breaker plate in this position, and it's going to be pretty tiresome in terms of pulling that breaker plate out, changing the screens, and putting it back. So quite often, people modify their system and put on some sort of hydraulic screen changer. And the hydraulic screen changer generally needs some distance in front of the breaker plate to create some sort of hydraulic seal arrangement in here. And so they have 3, 4, 5 inches prior to the breaker plate. And if the people that are replacing the system or adding the screen changer in don't modify the position of the screw, then we end up with a very large volume from the screw tip to the screen pack and breaker plate. Also, in order to facilitate pulling of the screw, they'll leave the section after the screen changer open, and if they want to pull the screw out, they'll simply index without a breaker plate to leave this open and then push the screw right through the screen changer without having to take off the screen changer. Both of these areas, if you do a simple calculation, result in a very, very low shear rate and very, very low shear stress. And I'll talk about their shear stress again in a moment. But there's also another problem. If you, let's say, were in the habit of shutting down your line on the Friday and starting back up on the Monday, this material in here that would freeze off, and in here that would freeze off, would take a much, much longer time to heat up than what the metal would and the thin layer of polymer, let's say, in the screw. And so you would very likely start the system up with a solid mass of polymer here and here, which would probably break the first set of screens that you have put in there and potentially get stuck upstream in the smaller channels of the die and so forth. So it's very important to correct any large volume areas. Now let's talk a little bit about shear stress. Shear stress is the product of viscosity times the shear rate. And whenever something is flowing in a channel, we have some velocity profile. The shear stress profile is always lowest or zero where the velocity is maximum, and maximum at the wall where the shear rate is maximum. So the shear rate is the slope of the velocity profile. So here against the wall is our maximum shear stress. And the reason we like to focus on shear stress is because this is what the polymer feels along the wall. And the shear stress is critical to the self-cleaning nature of the process and the equipment. The shear stress cleans the wall by scrubbing it, right? And it's this scrubbing action that keeps the system clean and prevents a buildup of degraded material. Now the question is, how high is enough? And based on our experience, we recommend values somewhere in the neighborhood of about 30 kilopascals. So you can see most polyolefins are about 30 kilopascals. PVC, perhaps a little bit higher shear stress on that wall to keep the wall clean. Now, how do you come up with these values? Well, basically, you get them by being there at the equipment when you take it apart, noticing regions where there's been a buildup, and then quickly calculating those regions under the conditions that you're running, and then comparing areas that are clean with areas that are not clean. So we were giving this presentation several years back for a group of people, and there were several people from one company. One of the managers came to us and explained to us a problem that he was having. Now, they had taken care about this. They had brought the screw tip to the screen changer. And typically, here, you're looking at about an eighth of an inch of clearance per inch of screw diameter. So you have a 4.5-inch screw. You've got to have about a half-inch distance between the tip of the screw to the screen pack. But that's about all you need. Now, this region over here, you want to quickly reduce down to the optimum diameter to avoid stagnation and degradation. And this was the area that this person had a trouble with. They brought us their transition, or what their supplier decided was the optimum transition. And he shows it here. This is a slug out of their transition or adapter. Over here is where their breaker plate is. I believe it was a 6-inch, 150-millimeter diameter here, and about a 1 3/4 diameter adapter. And you can see that their design had this hemispherical transition. And what you're seeing here is polymer, what they're processing is PVC. And the PVC is very, very good for showing stagnation areas, and it kind of grows like a cancer to build up a large degraded area. And for their product, what would happen is when this would build up, it would create a line on their product, a dark line, which was unacceptable. And so they had to budget 2 hours at the end of every shift to open this section up, clean this area, and put it back. And when we did the quick calculation of how much lost production that was about over €500,000 a year that they were wasting on this problem. We analyzed this problem by basically estimating the shape from the part that he showed us, the cutout that he showed us. And what you're seeing here is a 2D finite element analysis using the virtual extrusion laboratory, and the result that we've plotted on the surface on this color scale is the shear stress. And we're not really concerned about the shear stress in the center. We know the shear stress down the axis of symmetry is going to be essentially zero. But we're concerned about the shear stress along the wall. And so we can simply plot a graph of the shear stress along the wall. That's what's shown here. The high stress region here is where the channel has the smallest diameter. You can see the red color there being high stress. And we can see that the stress kind of reduces into a valley in here and then gets higher here because out of the breaker plate, we have more like plug flow. So the velocity is almost even everywhere out of here and then quickly starts to move in toward the center and you get your parabolic velocity profile. So the polymer tends to avoid this region right in here. And if we put a line here of where the degradation is of 30 kilopascals, 30, 35 kilopascals, we'll see it matches very, very closely to what was observed on the sample that he produced. So this is kind of how we determine what the shear stress is acceptable or what isn't. You can see there's no degradation here, and then degradation starts in this region over here, which corresponds to the region below that line. Now that we understand what our problem is, we can spend a little time to go through different design scenarios which will avoid the low stress region on this surface. And after some time, you'll figure out the solution is actually quite the opposite of what they had for their geometry. We have this kind of shape shown here. And if we plot the shear stress along this wall, we'll see a graph again. The stress is always higher where the diameter is lower. And then it reduces to some valley again. But if we put our critical value of 30, 35 kilopascals on this graph, we'll see that virtually that entire wall is above that critical value, and now we can avoid any stagnation because we know the shear stress is scrubbing that surface and it has the self-cleaning nature that we desire to avoid these problems. So the actual solution would be something more like this in terms of putting that transition in. And that's a very easy fix, much, much less than the 500,000 euro a year that they were wasting. Another excellent place to determine what the shear stress you need to avoid stagnation is a flat die manifold. This shows a flat die with some pitting. This is usually used to make PVC siding. They're about 20 inches wide. And the above image here that you can't see all of is the refurbished version of it. We wanted to see the pre version when they got it in, and you can see this pitting. Now with PVC, when it degrades, it forms corrosive byproducts like hydrochloric acid, and the hydrochloric acid can get into the micro cracks of the chrome and get down into the base metal and etch it away, and so you get this pitting happening when the PVC spends a long time in this portion of the die. So when we simulate this geometry, and this is our 3D finite element simulation and showing the shear stress on the surface, we can see that the manifold has a lower stress, of course, because it's a larger channel than the rest of the section. And then the stress gradually reduces because as the volume of material flows out of the manifold, the volume is reducing, but it's not really reducing at the rate at which the material is leaving, resulting the material, cause the material to slow down as it moves across the manifold, and ultimately it gets into a very low stress region. Now, these are just colors and they have really no meaning in terms of number until we put a meaning to them. And the way we do that is we go back to the geometry that we've opened up and looked at and said, oh, we have some pitting which appears to start, if we call it 3 inches, 75 millimeters from the edge of the die. Now we do our simulation and we go to the edge and move back 3 inches and say, what is the stress at this point? And we pick off a value, 25, 30, 35, 40, whatever stress value that we get, because we know this channel from here on is clean, and we have the problems from this point to this point. And the next time we order a flat die from our supplier, we'll say, can you please make sure that the manifold has higher than 30, 40 kilopascals all the way along right to the edge so that we can avoid this degradation and etching and pitting problem. So this is the way we can come out to use simulation to optimize our designs and slowly improve upon them and avoid these types of problems. Another area where they had degradation issues was in blown film. The problem appeared as faint lines on these spiral mandrel dies. So here's a spiral mandrel type die. This is just the mandrel. The body goes on top of this to form an annular flow channel. And the polymer flows from these ports, comes into the center of the die, comes out through these ports that are at 90 degrees. There's four of them. And then as the polymer flows along this spiral channel, there's a gap between the body and the mandrel here where the polymer can leak out in a controlled fashion. And this spiral travels all the way around, and comes out here, actually travels 360 degrees. So it ends over top of itself. And the particular customer was producing this film, and they had these lines, very distinct lines in their product, equal to the number of spirals. Now, we're looking at it and saying, okay, where's this coming from? Now, when you look at a die with a body on it, all you see is a big hunk of metal. And it's hard to kind of really distinguish what's causing this problem. Now, in the particular die that was actually having the problem was a large die making greenhouse film. You can see these lines here in the product. It's actually more easier to see them here. And this is what they were complaining about. And in fact, the material would prematurely degrade along these lines. You can see here the failure, the ripping of the material along these particular lines. And so they wanted to correct this. First, they got to find out where it's coming from. So we do a finite element simulation, a 3D finite element simulation of the geometry. And the nice thing about spiral mandrel dies is they have a periodic flow field. This section repeats as many spirals as you have. So we take advantage of that whenever we do simulation to speed up the calculations. And we show here the pressure contour of the particular geometry and the velocity profile at the exit of the spiral section. And there's absolutely nothing here to indicate that there's a problem with this geometry. The pressure profile looks good, it's gradual. The velocity distribution looks very, very even. And so we have to look at another parameter. And the way we analyze this was to put in path lines. So here, what we do is we put in particle path lines at the start of each spiral channel, and we follow them along. And what we notice is that the polymer path lines are actually going back and up, while some are going forward, and they seem to meet at this position here. So these path lines are not following a straight through pattern as we thought they might with a spiral die. They actually go back down the previous channel, and this backflow results in the formation of a weld line and due to a stagnation area right here where the polymer is kind of avoiding. And this is what was obvious in the product. Now since finding them in this geometry, we know that they're not only possible in conventional spiral mandrel dies. This type of problem can also be on flat spiral dies. So this is a spiral die, but on a surface of a disc. And if we study this spiral distribution system, if it's not designed right, we can have the same sort of behavior where the path lines will be coming out of the channel and then going back the previous channel. And what we're showing on this color contour is the shear stress. And red is high and blue is low. And you can see these blue stress regions which are the very low stress, high residence time material, and that's the material that's essentially forming the weld line that then appears on the final product. So this is virtually impossible to see with a metal system. Only simulation will really show you this type of behavior. And once you understand that this is bad, we don't want to have this type of flow behavior, then you can modify and optimize the geometry so that all of the particle path lines are proceeding in the right direction and none are crossing back to create a dead flow area, and we don't have any low shear stress regions. So the solution to polymer degradation: ensure adequate shear stress in all flow channels, and ensure you have a proper channel design and proper operating conditions, because the most highly polished and optimized channel will still degrade if you're running the polymer that wasn't designed for it, or you're running a very, very high melt temperature from your extruder, which reduces the viscosity and reduces the shear stress at the wall from what it was designed for, or if you're running at a much lower flow rate than the die was designed for. So we need proper channel design and proper operating conditions in order to avoid degradation.